Thanks for the nice introduction. Good evening to all. Nice to be back. I only last almost 10 months to 1 year I was not able to attend the meetings, being a member of AMA Kodamba. So this season is always busy for us. So we work almost every day. So because of monsoon digging in and producing all tropical infections. So a very important topic I wanted to discuss today. So everybody thinks when patient is diagnosed with dengue fever, so everybody is afraid. The patient is afraid, relatives are afraid. So nothing to be afraid in this. And the other query is whether I can manage dengue patient in a nursing home or a primary care center. So this will be discussed today. So dengue is an infection which does not cause complications for all patients. To put it in a nutshell, it's only 1% of patients will go for complications. And sadly, we lost a young, we would have read in the newspaper, a young boy, so in Andhra, he was referred from Chittoor to Bangalore on the way he died. Because only for 3 days he had fever. He was diagnosed with dengue and we don't know what happened. So what should be done for a dengue patient, whether we can manage here or whether you have to manage as OP, that is also is there. Sir, dengue fever you are saying, but how can you say it can be managed as OP? Definitely it can be done. Not that all dengue fevers need admission. So we will be discussing what are the guidelines. So we'll have a case scenario before we discuss what is dengue, how to go about dengue with warning signs, dengue without warning signs and severe dengue. So this will be a discussion for today and how to identify it's a dengue. It's very, very tough because first 3 days all fevers mimic same. All fevers are similar, all have similar symptoms. A difference will be in some subtle signs to find out whether it's dengue or not. So first 3 days is always any febrile illness, first 3 days very, very, very tough to diagnose whether it is dengue or not. So this is a patient, what is your female? The patient has come, fever for 3 days. She has cough, pain, right hypochondrium and vomiting. So dengue can have any symptom. That is the most important thing. It can have respiratory symptom, it can have GI symptoms. So any system it can affect the kidney, it can affect the CNS also. The patient can present with seizures also. So that is the reason, so not that even respiratory infection can initially the symptom of dengue. The patient did not have, so had severe body ache and headache, no dysuria. Clinical examination, congested eyes, congenital congestion was there, and no neck stiffness. Temperature was 102, pulse was 110, BP was 100/60. There was dehydration, examination was normal, CVSRS, everything was normal. There was a 10 palpable liver, 4 cm below the costal margin. So what should be the diagnosis of the patient? So it's a 3 days fever, acute febrile illness. So, and without any localization except for a hepatomegaly. The pharynx is also normal. The patient has a cough which is insignificant, no lung signs, CVS, everything is normal. Liver is palpable. So very tough to say whether it is dengue or not. This same patient comes to your outpatient clinic. What should be done? And what are the differential diagnoses? That is why the government has clearly given a direction and it says all fevers, the present scenario, should be evaluated for all causes. Dengue, malaria, lepto. If you are suspecting other infections, you have to definitely work up for that. So because dengue can mimic any infection, initial symptoms can be subtle. So we have to have some idea about what are the possibilities. So we should evaluate further. If you want to do test first day of fever, suppose the patient can, yesterday evening fever started, today is coming to your clinic. So what will you do? We will not do any tests except we will order for a NS1 antigen. Just hydrate yourself, go home, don't worry. Just have a NS1 test done, come to me. So NS1 usually takes a day, don't do CAR tests. Never do agree on a CAR test. It should be ELISA, which is standardized. So do from standard labs where they give a clear NS1 report with a title. So NS1 is positive, then we can have what should be done next. So this patient we worked up. So these are the labs, initial labs. Usually females have anemia, definitely we see. Whether the anemia is due to bleeding, we don't know. So these are some important clues how to work up, right? Then protein count is 5200, platelets low, urea creatinine elevated, bilirubin is elevated along with liver enzymes, OT is higher than. So what is the possibility now? Sorry, that is hemoglobin is 8.2 only, it is 8.2. So what is the possibility now? The problem is the patient has thrombocytopenia, urea 54, creatinine 1.9, renal involvement, liver is also, enzymes are deranged. Now, you should be very careful in treating this patient, whether we have to refer the patient or treat in a primary care. That is the only worry. So, what should be in mind is, what are the complications this patient is likely to develop? Very, very important. What are the signs you should look for? The complications. Then, what are the parameters to monitor for complications? What all you look for to monitor the complications? And how do you manage this patient? If these three are addressed, you can treat the patient. If you have this setup, you can treat your patient. But if you are not, if you are not, unlikely, you cannot treat this patient in your setup, better refer the patient. If you are not able to do these three things, better refer the patient. That is the point of referral. Yes. So WHS totally revised the definition. Only three conditions. So it initially dengue shock syndrome, dengue hemorrhage fever, nothing is there. Warning signs, no warning signs. Or severe dengue. That's all. Only three. So if there is no warning signs, no problem. You can manage at home. Or the patient is worried, relatives are worried. Keep them in your nursing home or a primary care, you can manage. Warning signs and severe dengue, refer. Don't keep the patient unless you have the proper setup for management. So what are the warning signs and without warning signs? So this will be there for all patients. The last one, usually we don't. Usually at 20 millimeter above the systolic BP, you type and see for a 1 centimeter area of square centimeter area where there will be 20 bleeding points. Petty K will be seen. That is positive tourniquet test. We don't do for patients. So others will be common for patients. Leukopenia. Here thrombocytopenia is not mentioned. So what is the next thing? What happens is, what happened to that boy? Dengue causes complications from the end of 30. If the patient passes through the 4th, 5th and 6th day, by the end of 5th day, the patient is stable, don't worry, he is not going to have any complication. That is the usual dictum in dengue. There are exceptions, I will tell you what are the exceptions, but first 3 days, from the 4th day, you should be crucial in monitoring the complications, very, very important. So what are the complications the patient will develop? Third phase collection, ascites, proliferation. Any patient having abdominal pain, persistent vomiting, it's a warning sign. Because they will not take oral, if you give IV. So other things I will be discussing about, avoid excessive IV fluids. Why excessive IV fluids? There is a capillary leak. In dengue what happens is, there is a capillary leak. You give more of giving on IV fluids, what happens in primary care? They don't know what is to be done. They will give 3 liters of saline, 2 liters of saline, rush. What happens? Everything leaks and goes to the pleura and the abdomen, peritoneal space. The patient develops pleural effusion and ascites, patient worsens. So IV treatment is not the dictum for any patient. You should always encourage oral fluids. That is the dictum in dengue. So any bleeding at all, you know, lethargy, letters, definitely these things, other things you can definitely, you can recognize increase in hematocrit. So what you monitor in dengue is not daily platelets alone. You monitor hemoglobin along with PCV, very, very important. We monitor hemoglobin with PCV. That will say whether the patient has hemo concentration. Severe dengue. So, we have resuscitated dengue patients. This in severe dengue, especially young patients, usually have a very good survival. There will be a specific group of patients that are very at risk of lesser survival. They may die also. So we'll be discussing what are the group of patients. We should be very careful. Especially young patients with severe dengue, they can recover also. So severe dengue, along with their surface collection, bleeding, shock, LFT involvement, it is more than 1,000. Then CNS involvement, any organ failure. So this patient will fit into severe dengue. The patient has AKI, acute kidney injury. The creatinine is 1.9, urea is 54. So this patient will fit into severe dengue. So never take a chance of treating a severe dengue patient. Any of the criteria will be met. The patient BP is normal now, but organ involvement will say that the patient is having severe dengue. So can you manage outpatient? Definitely. In India, guidelines cannot be blindly followed. That is a problem in India. Any textbook will say these are the guidelines, but we cannot follow guidelines in India because totally it's different. The patient will question us, why you are not treated dengue patient? Why? The most important thing if you see is the patient is able to tolerate oral fluids. That is the most important thing to decide whether it is outpatient admission or whether it is without warning signs, with warning signs. The patient is not taking oral fluids, urinates at least once every 6 hours, then you can never manage as OP. All the high risk groups, pregnancy, infancy, old age, diabetes, renal failure, any hemolytic disease, obesity, poor social involved, most all go to GH. Most of the patients coming from low social situation, they usually be referred to GH. So tolerate oral fluids, definitely you can always tell the patient, you wait for 1 day or 2 days. If you are not able to hydrate yourself, approximately 4 to 5 liters per day you are able to take orally, you can definitely manage. Come on the third day with the hematocrit and platelets. That's you can always advise the patient. But this group of patients always admit, never take a chance. They will go for complications. So inpatient, as I told you, we are not going to discuss much. Coexisting diseases, severe dengue or warning signs, all should be admitted. This is what should have happened to that young boy. Unpredictable. Dramatic plasma leakage is unpredictable and depends on the serotype of dengue. There are 4 serotypes. As I told you, primary dengue usually has no complications. Suppose the patient develops secondary dengue. How do you identify secondary dengue is, you do IgG. The patient report will show as IgG positive, IgM negative. So those patients are secondary dengue. Secondary dengue with a different serotype is always, almost always lethal. So very important, they will go for complications. Secondary dengue may go for complications, usually attained by 72 hours, 4th day. Beginning of 4th day, the patient starts. Sudden plasma leakage, how do you identify is? Sudden drop in BP. What is very important is drop in systolic BP. The patient diastolic BP may be 70. 100 by 70 could have become 80 by 70. So 10 millimeter or 90 by 70. 10 millimeter of systolic BP says that the patient is going for shock. So you should be very careful to monitor. It is very third and seventh day of illness, very important, maximum risk. And everybody feels that when fever subsides, everything is okay. No. 24 hours before and after effervescence, fever subsides, the patient goes for complications. Plasma leakage occurs. All the complications are related to plasma leakage, extensive plasma leakage. So always prefer normal saline. Don't give other fluids. You can prefer ring and lactate at sometimes, but NS is the preferred fluid of choice, no other fluids in dengue.
Never.
Colloids are specific indication. Recently, 2 days back, we had given colloids for a patient. Dramatically, they improved. In severe dengue, when there is a sudden drop in BP, the patient has bleeding, active bleeding, and IV fluids are not improving the BP. You give a fluid challenge, the BP has to improve. It is not improving. That is the only problem with, that is the situation where you give dextran. What is the problem with dextran is, it is high molecular weight. It will block the renal tubules, glomerulus, and cause further worsen renal damage. That is why you should restrict dextran, high molecular weight, for patients with resistant shock, intractable shock, resistant to crystalloids. So don't give dextrans for all patients. The other things what we monitor is acidosis, hypoglycemia, hypocalcemia, rare complications. As I told you, every time it was checked for BP and fall in hematocrit. It's very important, you monitor hematocrit daily. So what about the differential diagnosis for this patient? So why I wanted to show is SGOT more than SGPT. SGOT more than SGPT is only two conditions, alcohol or dehydration, because SGOT is coming from the muscle. So the other sources of SGOT. So SGPT is more than SGOT is always liver. So SGOT is raised means it is dehydration. So you should be very careful. Except in alcoholics, other conditions, only dehydration, SGOT. This patient had 416 of SGOT, 206 of SGPT. So that says that the patient has dehydration. All this SGOT, SGPT, if it is more than 500,000, you always suspect viral hepatitis. Then cholestasis, in some viral hepatitis, usually it is not a marker. Coagulation profile usually is altered in viral hepatitis complications. Dengue also, severe dengue can have altered coagulation profile. In malaria also can produce the same picture. Falciparum malaria can produce the same picture. Anemia can occur in falciparum malaria. Counts will be normal, platelets can be low. But what happens is usually it's an indirect bilirubin which is more than the diet. That says the patient has hemolysis. So that is a clue that the patient is having other conditions. You should be very clear about to rule out differential diagnosis. Blood products, very, very important. No unnecessary platelets. All the patient asks, sir, 50,000 has come. It is 50,000, why you are not transfusing? My patient is there, 50,000 you are not. You should be able to convince the patient, you are giving a blood from a different person. You induce allele antibodies from a different donor. You have to explain to the patient, unnecessary transfusions will produce antibodies in you. He will keep quiet. There is specific indication, unless the platelets are less than 10,000, there is bleeding. Patient has black tarry stool, melena or gum bleed. Usually, never transfuse. No prophylactic transfusion. Blood products are given with, for that there is a fall in hematocrit with hypotension, active bleeding, then only you give blood. Whole blood or axils can be given. Avoid. Also, always I told you, it's always oral than IV. Never prefer IV means everything will settle. No. It can go for plasma leakage and worsen ascites and proliferation. Avoid NSAIDs, steroids. Avoid antibiotics. Except paracetamol, no NSAIDs. They will further worsen the platelet function. Don't give. No prophylactic platelet transfusion. It's very important. So what will the take home message from this? So when will we refer? As a summarize, warning signs, severe dengue, platelet less than 50,000. So these group of patients will be less actually, around 60, 70, they will again recover. Fifth day, by sixth, starting of sixth day, platelets begin to improve. By 5 days, he has passed the illness, sixth day, seventh day, usually no problem. By fourth day, the patient has complications, can extend till 1 week to 10 days. So it will be, you should monitor which all patients. Then children, any comorbids, diabetes, other comorbids the patient is having, pregnancy, never ever manage in a primary care center. Don't manage in a primary care center. So these are the take home points for this talk. Agra aggressive management of warning signs, dengue with warning signs and severe dengue. The guidelines for admission is very, very clear, who all has to be admitted. And the last one is early recognition of warning signs is to be monitored. It's crucial for referral to higher center. Any questions I will be willing to answer. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity. Is available, you can give. The patient is not able to take your orally, you can give IV paracetamol. IV will cause again hematoma. The platelets are less than 1 lakh. Any thrombocytopenia, better not give IV. Better not give. IV paracetamol is available.
You advise papaya? Papaya,
it's a good question. As the government recommends, it's a recommendation of the government. It says that papaya leaf extract and nilavembu. Government has advised. So, whether it is going to improve, we don't know, but we have seen patients improving. So, you cannot drink papaya extract. So, it is available as a pill, capsule actually is available. You can give that. Syrup is also available for pediatric groups. Even the patient is vomiting, even adults have vomiting, you can give syrup. Or nilavembu is very, very tough to drink. Very tough. Nobody can drink. Nobody can drink. I drink daily. Not for that. Not daily. During fever, sometimes if you better, weekly once you take nilavembu, it's always good for you. Not daily. It's good for you. But it's very bitter. But if you will adjust to the taste when you take regularly, it's a good one.
What is the indication?
See, all the usually it is almost 95% is viral. So if you give antibiotics, see thing what happens is any nursing home setup or any primary care, what they give azithromycin and ceftriaxone, something like that they give. Ceftriaxone can further worsen the platelets. They will be going on giving ceftriaxone, the platelets will be going on dropping. And they will say the fourth day I have given antibiotic, the fever has subsided. The fever has not subsided because of ceftriaxone. The illness is subsided. It's going for complications. From fifth day, the patient, fourth or fifth day, the patient go for complications.
You don't give platelet transfusion unless it comes to less than 10,000.
Yes, yes, yes. Don't give. 20 at least. Not more than 20, we will never transfuse. 10 to 20 is the group where all the nudging attenders, still we tell them, is it okay? We introduce antibodies. 90% will become silent. You are transfusing a blood from a different person.
Recent guidelines say that no role for platelets. If at all you want, platelets is only for monitoring the clinical condition. If at all, give cold blood, not platelets. Even if you are giving platelets, they will be destroyed.
No. There is no antibody here. Virus will destroy the.
No, sir.
See,
platelets is because of.
There is no production of antibody. What virus does
this? Platelets you are giving are getting destroyed. The latest WHO guidelines is there is no role for platelets.
WHO the guideline says is 5,000. WHO guideline clearly says less than 5,000 you transfuse. UK guideline says less than 10,000.
Whole blood, not platelets.
Whole blood is never available in India. Our government dictum is it has to be products. You get back cell or products because it's getting wasted. So even in Ramchandra, if you have any blood bank, you say it is separated. So you have a whole blood, platelets, FFP, everything should be separated. That is what is the dictum. So you don't get whole blood, you can give back cell. Back cell indication, as I told you, when there is a fall in hematocrit, BP is low, active bleeding. When there is active bleeding, you have to give platelets. These platelets are only temporary, as I told you. Again, the virus is going to destroy the platelets, but you are going to prevent bleeding by just minimal improvement in the platelets.
What's antiviral?
Yes?
Antiviral.
Pelapavir was tried and they had a trial. They tried every chloroquine also, they tried pelapavir, all antivirals, even alpha glucosidase inhibitors, they were tried, but nothing was found beneficial. Even the vaccine, they have four types of tetravalent vaccine was launched actually, but it is only 60% efficacious. It's not going to affect now.
Randomized control study has been done with regard to use of papaya and IV.
It cannot be done, sir. Because randomized needs a patient to be grouped into two. A dengue patient, how can we group the patient with standard treatment with nilavembo and this? Somebody goes for a complication, there will be legal issues. Dengue, you cannot do that. But the patient is mild infection without warning signs, you can do. But without
warning signs, can be, it's a self-limiting disease.
It's a self-limiting
disease.
That's what I told you. What kills the patient is plasma leakage. It happens only in 1 to 2% of patients, not in all patients. You tell the, don't ask the patient to get afraid. 100 patients vanda or rendu orthar rendu perdanga problem varum, wait pannunga. Platelet sir, 1 lakh la irundhu 30000 vandhuchu sir, onnume pannama irukku. This is the question they ask. This is what is dengue, you have to wait. You assure the patient, reassure the patient, talk to the patient. No complaints, they will not complain. That is when there is a coagulopathy. Coagulopathy. INR is elevated, PTT, partial thrombocytosis, time is elevated. Then you have to give FFP along with blood with platelets. Yes, definitely patients have to be isolated. There should be a net. This dengue ward has specific specifications we have in SRMC. There are specifications, full net.
It is contagious.
It is not contagious. We cannot prevent mosquitoes in the hospital. See, entering of mosquitoes through windows, nobody can prevent. What we are going to prevent is the mosquito biting the patient, going to some other patient and biting. That's all we are going to prevent. That is why we needed isolation. That's all. It is not going to spread from one patient to patient. Yes, PCR is there. PCR will be positive as early as first day. NS1 is also positive in the first day itself. IgM should not be done in the first 3 days. At least after 72 hours only you have to do a dengue serology. First day you do a serology, it will be negative. After 72 hours only you have to do it.
ELISA
is a standard specification. It's a card test. Usually any card test if you see. So it is only 90%. I am not saying it's 100%. It's not saying zero. Here ELISA is 100%. It is 90%. So you'll be missing 10% of patients which may become negative or false positive also. That is why we are worried about the card test. If it gives a negative report, no problem. It's a problem. Positive report, we'll definitely going to treat. Gives a negative report, you tell the patient, negative, go. So that may patient go, may go for complications.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Okay, sir. Thank you.